early on, Alexander Hamilton was a huge proponent of establishing a central bank and ultimately won that argument with the First Bank of the United States, although it wasn't called the First Bank at the time, the Bank of the United States, which was actually opposed by Jefferson, who thought that Congress had no authority to establish a central bank or mess around in the banking sector. Now, the First Bank of the United States did more than the Federal Reserve does. It was in many ways much more of a commercial bank than a purely central bank. But the arguments weren't wildly different at the time. The First Bank was established to help finance government after the Revolutionary War and as the economy was getting going. Hamilton was really big on the idea that you really needed a sophisticated financial market to really get an economy functioning in a sophisticated way. That's been borne out academically, but if you look in academic literature, there's a striking relationship between developed financial markets and developed economies, that it's very difficult to get a really developed industrial economy going without a pretty sophisticated financial sector. So in that sense, Hamilton was right, but that doesn't mean that Jefferson was wrong in saying that it couldn't have happened outside of establishing the First Bank of the U.S. So, I mean, that's just a debate that's going to be carried on forever. It is true that, you know, all developed economies have central banks, and a lot of undeveloped economies have central banks. But it is something that we've struggled with since kind of the beginning of time. And the First Bank died in 1811 when its charter wasn't renewed, that there was a deep suspicion of kind of concentrated financial power. And so that killed off the First Bank. Problem was, the next year we had the War of 1812. And again, there were a lot of financial problems for the government. And so by 1816, we got the Second Bank of the United States to mitigate the difficulties of being able to pay for the war and the kind of aftermath of it. That charter was not renewed after its 20 years expired. And we went to what was known as a period of free banking. The free banking era was kind of interesting because it was really up to the states to determine what went on, and different states did different things. A lot of state banks issued their own currencies. A lot of these currencies were counterfeited rather profusely, so there was actually, at one point, I think in the mid-1800s, about a third of the currency in circulation was fake. That's a big problem. There's a big problem in that it was not necessarily the case that checks or even bills would necessarily clear at par. So if you had a check for a dollar when you went to cash it in, you may get something less than that. Those were big issues that kind of go back to the kind of core of the central bank debate, the kind of coordinated and unified, organized banking system that facilitates transactions in a relatively smooth way. In 1863, we got the National Banking Act. We established the dollar as the nation's currency in a unified way, put a heavy tax on state banknotes that pretty much drove them out of business.